Hi, hello, namaste. In this section, we'll be seeing a small derivation with respect to magnetic field intensity. So what we are doing here is, we are actually calculating a magnetic field intensity at a point P. So let me call this as a point P. So I want to find the magnetic field intensity at this point due to a conductor which is placed on my Z axis. So to represent the conductor, what I'll do is I will draw a conductor over here. Okay, so this is the conductor of some bigger thickness. So let us assume this as the conductor. So with this, we now want to solve for the current. So how to solve it? What we know here is there is a current that is flowing through this particular conductor. Let me call that current as I, which is flowing like this. Okay, and I'll be taking two points. So this is point A, one end of the conductor, and this is point B, which is another end of the conductor. Okay, so this points A and B is making an angle alpha 1 and alpha 2 to my point P. So I'll show that. So this is one particular point P, and from point P have another line. So I'll just try to represent this in a dashed lines form. So these are the two lines that I have at the both the angles, I mean both the points, where at point B it is making an angle alpha 2, at point A it is making an angle alpha 1. So what I do now is I basically consider a small incremental length or a current element. So small current element is considered somewhere here in between this. I'll be calling this region as my DL. Okay, I'll be calling this as DL, a current element. So what I do now is I'll be taking the mid of this particular DL and I'll be calling this DL to be situated somewhere above. So this DL is situated somewhere above Z. So this is situated at an height of Z from the origin. So don't get confused, this A is the starting of this particular line element. So I'll write it here. This is A, this is B. So it is at a height, and the distance between my origin and the distance between my origin to that of the point P where I am calculating the current is nothing but rho. Okay, this is nothing but rho. So if I'm considering this as my current element, what I do is I'll be considering the midpoint of my current element. So this is the midpoint of my current element, and from that midpoint I'll be trying to join a straight line towards my point P. So from this point I'll be trying to join a straight line. So this point is named as R, or the distance from that mid of my current element to this point P is given by a vector R. Okay. So what I am interested is, I want to find the magnetic, the magnetic field intensity at this point P. So how can we solve for this? Give your thoughts now. Yes, we know now Biot-Savart's law. We have already come across Biot-Savart's law. So what is that Biot-Savart's law? Biot-Savart's law stated that the magnetic field intensity at a point P can be calculated by the current element times dl cross the unit vector ar the whole divided by 4 pi r square. So this was what the Biot-Savart's law stated. So to simplify this equation further, we know we had did this particular simplification. Dh vector can be written as I dl cross this ar vector, this ar unit vector with respect to this we are speaking, this is the unit vector ar cap. So that can be represent in terms of my vector. So how can I represent a unit vector? Unit vector is represented by the actual vector divided by the magnitude of the vector r, right? So if I substitute that over here, this becomes vector r the whole thing divided by 4 pi r cube, because r square times the magnitude of r is nothing but again the r, so that will become r cube. Okay, so this is my expression. But now if you see this expression, what is dl? So what is the vector dl? So if you see this particular part, so here we call this as the differential element dl. Dl is situated on z axis, so that means dl is nothing but it is having a variable in terms of dz times z axis, right? So dl vector can be represented by a small portion of z axis with respect to az. Similarly, my vector r can be written as it is having a variable in terms of rho is the distance or radius. I'm representing this in cylindrical coordinate system, rho, phi and z. Okay, so my r vector or the distance vector can be represented as rho in the direction rho cap. So it can vary in the direction of rho, and it is now in the negative z axis direction. Hence I can write it as minus c times az cap. So this is how I represent the vector r, or the vector which joins the line and the current element. Now you know from the basic principle of cross product, dl cross r can simply be written as what? In cross product, the rule is very simple. If I have similar axis getting cross product, that will be zero. If I have cross product with respect to the unsimilar or other two axes, then the answer will be the third axis, right? Remember this. So here, if I say, if I multiply this whole term, that is this whole term and this term, the AZ term and AZ term will be getting cancelled off because they both are on same plane or same axis. Okay, same axis, that is nothing but zero. So I'll be ending up at rho times dz, and it is az cross a rho. So by now you should be knowing that it is nothing but dz, rho dz times a phi cap. So this is the solution for dl cross r. So if I substitute this in my expression becomes th is equal to I times rho dz in the direction phi cap, the whole divided by 4 pi r cubed, right? This is what my expression becomes. But in the denominator, this magnitude of r can also be written, right? Since I know the vector now, this equation can also be written in terms of the magnitude of r. So this becomes divided by 4 pi. Magnitude of r is nothing but square root of x. This is a rho cap and a z cap. Those magnitudes can be squared. So that means it is rho square plus z square, the whole cube. So this is how my expression for dh has been simplified now. Now comes the interesting part, the substitutions part. Okay, so what is my dz? I have to solve for dz now. If you see here in this figure, okay, I'll try to erase this whole part and let us now understand this part. So how can I solve here? And one more thing, this r, let me call this as making an angle alpha. Okay, so how to solve for this particular thing? There are many different triangles that you are seeing, but what I'll be doing is I'll be only considering the triangle which I'll be highlighting now. Okay, you can only consider this triangle. Considering this triangle, when I apply cos alpha, I'll be getting z divided by r, right? Similarly, when I apply sine alpha, it is nothing but opposite by adjacent. So opposite is rho, opposite by hypotenuse. So this is r. So this is what I have got. So if I say I need z, right? In this expression, I need to solve for z so that I'll be getting dz. So to get z, what I do is I solve for cot alpha. Cot alpha can be written as cos by sine, or it is z by rho, or z is nothing but rho cot alpha. So if z is rho cot alpha, if I differentiate this with respect to z, then this equation becomes cot alpha is nothing but minus cosecant square alpha. So it is minus rho cosecant square alpha in times of d alpha is what my derivation becomes here. So substituting this in my expression here, I can replace this, or I can modify this as I times rho into minus rho cosecant square alpha times d alpha, the whole divided by 4 pi. Okay, let us also solve for this. What is rho? If you see this particular thing, Can I solve for rho? Rho is nothing but r sine alpha, and z is nothing but r cos alpha. Substituting that in this particular expression, this becomes, I'll be taking square root outside, it will be like 3 over 2. So this will be r square sine square theta plus, I mean not theta, pardon me, it is alpha. So alpha plus r square cos square alpha. Taking r square common, it will be like, so I'll be just solving for this. Taking r square common, it will be like sine square plus cos square, that is nothing but 1. So this whole term is having a power of 3 by 2. So 2 get cancelled, it is r cube, right? So this whole expression now can be simply written as I times or minus I into rho square cosecant square alpha divided by 4 pi into r cube. But what is r from this figure? R was nothing but, if I solve for r from this expression, r can be written as what? R is nothing but rho over sine, or 1 by sine can be written as cosecant square, sorry, cosec alpha. So in terms of r, I'll be replacing with rho cosec alpha. So this becomes now minus I divided by 4 pi into rho cube cosec cube alpha. The whole thing above, I'll be having rho square cosecant square alpha d alpha in the direction phi cap or a phi cap. So this is my magnetic field intensity at a point B. This is incremental or elemental magnetic field. So if you want to find the total magnetic field due to this whole conductor, if you want to calculate the total magnetic field due to this whole conductor AB, what I have to do? I have to do integration of this with respect to A and B, so that I'll be getting the final H. So if I integrate this with the equation between A and B, I'll be getting the solution. Before integration, you can cancel off this cosecant square, and my solution for H can simply be written as A to B minus, will be coming out, it is I times I divided by 4 pi rho, and 1 over cosecant can be written as what? Sine alpha d alpha in the direction a phi. But now if you see that particular diagram, my A is making an angle phi 1. My A is making an angle phi 1. So I'll take off this part. My A is making an angle phi 1 and my B is making an angle phi 2. So since my integral is with respect to angle over here, I can replace this integral by 4 pi rho, which is a constant. This A can be written as alpha 1, B is at alpha 2, sine of alpha d alpha. So solving for this expression, pause the video now, at least try to solve this and get the solution. If you don't get, I'll help you out, not a problem. So on solving this, I will be getting, so sine is nothing but minus cos alpha between alpha 2 and alpha 1 times a phi cap. So minus minus can be taken off, so this particular expression can be written as 4 pi sigma into cos of alpha 2
minus cos of alpha 1 times a phi cap. So this is the expression for my magnetic field intensity at that point P. Okay, this is the expression for magnetic field intensity at that point P. But what if I consider that, since we have taken something like this, let me say my conductor A is placed at origin and B at some point at infinity. So 0, 0, infinity is where my point B lies and A lies at origin. And I am finding the point P, the intensity, the magnetic field intensity at the point P. So what can I do in this expression? If you see this expression, I can replace this expression, or I can try to solve this expression as I divided by 4 pi sigma, mean the rho, the distance from origin to the point P, that is rho, times what happens to my alpha 2. Alpha 2 is this point, right? As it goes to infinity, as it goes away and away, can you see the alpha keeps on decreasing, alpha 2 keeps on decreasing. At infinity, my alpha looks something like, alpha 2 looks like 0 degree. So this becomes 0, okay, minus cos of alpha 1. It is at origin, the alpha here is what? Alpha 1 is 90 degree. So cos of 90 degree. You know cos of 90 goes to 0. So this whole cos of 1 is 1, I mean cos of 0 is 1. And this expression for a case where your A is at origin and B is at infinity, the for that condition my magnetic field intensity is written by I divided by 4 pi rho in the direction A phi cap. This is one condition. What if my conductor itself is infinity? That means the conductor starts at negative infinity and goes to positive infinity. At this point, if I am calculating, so let us take this as origin, I am calculating at point P. So this angle is alpha 1, this angle is alpha 2, right? You can see alpha 1 at infinity, minus infinity, will look like 180 degree, and alpha 2 at positive infinity look like 0. So in this expression, if I use that particular thing in this expression, okay, in this expression, if I use alpha 1 and alpha 2 as 180 degree and 0, my expression can be written as I divided by 4 pi rho times cos of alpha 1 can be written as 180 degree minus cos of, I mean it is cos of alpha 2 minus alpha 1. So cos of alpha 2 can be written as 0 minus cos of alpha 1, which is nothing but 180 degree. So solving this, cos of 0 is 1 and cos of 180 degree. So if you have a doubt, you can just take this particular diagram. So cos of 0 is 1, 90 it is 0, 180 degree it is minus 1, right? And it continues. So this will be minus 1. So on solving this, this whole term becomes 2. So it is like 2i divided by 4 pi in rho, and this get cancelled. So my magnetic field intensity at a point P due to infinite conductor or infinite straight conductor is given by I divided by 2 pi rho, where rho is the distance between your current element and the point P, the origin of the current element and the point P where you are finding the magnetic field intensity. So this is the whole derivation of magnetic field intensity at a point P. And yeah, I forgot this, it is having a direction A phi cap. That means to say, if I say this is a conductor and this is the flux around the conductor, okay? So if I say this angle is nothing but phi, right? So if I take a tangent on this, this is my A phi cap. So that is what this particular thing states. So A phi here, I'm not able to show it in actual 3D. So A phi, if I calculate here, it will be like this. The vector is going into the board. If I calculate A phi here, it will be coming out of the board or out of the screen. So this is how we calculate magnetic field intensity at a point P using Bio-Savart's law. If any doubts, any queries, please feel free to contact me. I hope I have made a lengthy video, sorry for that, but hope the knowledge is transferred. Thank you.